and gentlemen, I present to you my friend John Barbour. I also forgot to mention this. He is only a 5-time Emmy Award winner.
Ladies and gentlemen, and those of you who are undecided, for 50 years, I have been in the heart of show business and in the rump of show business. I have spoken to 25 people. I have spoken to 5,000 people, 1,000 times, in those 50 years, all the way from Australia to Europe, to England, to Scotland, to Canada, universities around this country. I have been introduced 1,000 times. And I must say, as you've just seen, Gary Fannin's is the most recent. I am proud, happy, and delighted that I'm speaking to you here today. But I would be prouder and happier if I were not speaking to you here today. That I were speaking to you in front of the Justice Department in Washington, D.C., where the cold case of John Kennedy is still uninvestigated, even though ordered to do so in 1979 by the House Select Committee on Assassinations. That's where we should be. We should not be here. I am here for four reasons. The first of which is to find out what I have to say. No matter how well I prepare a speech or try to make something interesting for you to listen to and something interesting for me to say, I always end up interrupting myself and I say something that I'm sure is going to offend all of you. And I would like to apologize beforehand, but I won't apologize because I wouldn't be saying it but I didn't want to say it. So if you're offended, you're just going to have to live with it. I've done this all my life, no matter where I was, and it started very, very young for me. You know, things would just pop out of my mouth. When I was 12 years age, I was at a school, Adam Beck School in Toronto, Canada. Our teacher was Mr. Hetherington, and it's interesting how you can remember the names of some of the teachers that you had as a young person. Mr. Hetherington was the fattest man in Canada. As a matter of fact, he was the only fat man in Canada. I never saw fat people until I came to the United States. And that was before McDonald's. I mean, so many Americans are so fat now they have to take the word of someone that their shoes are clean. Anyway, Mr. Hetherington was one of these miserable human beings that was mad at the world, mad at everything. He had to have a special chair built by the carpentry department so he could sit by his desk. Every time he started the class, before he would start the class, there was a catalog of ales and ailments. It was difficult to listen to, but he was a very bright history teacher. Anyway, one day he wobbles in and he sits down and moaning and groaning and he leans over and he presses his hand against his leg and he said, "Oh, God, my ankles are swollen." I'm sitting in the back of the room and I just mumble, "How can you tell?" Well, in those days, they had canes and sticks and rulers. The rulers weren't a foot long, they were 3 feet long, and they could walk down and they would whack you. And parents would applaud it. Society would applaud it. The police department would applaud it. It was allowed. Corporal punishment. I had psychic scars to this day to prove it. Anyway, he drags me into the principal's office, and I'm telling him, you don't have to drag me, sir. I know the way. I've been there many times. And they used to keep a strap. It was a leather strap tied together with wire, and they kept it in a cold glass of lemon water so that then when they whacked your hands, and they would whack, they would hold your wrist, whack your hands, so your hands would bleed, and then the lemon gets in there, and it really hurts. The principal is about to do me again. I had it done very, very well. And he says to me as he grabs my hand, and this is the third time he said it to me. He said, John, this is going to hurt me more than it's going to hurt you. So before he struck me, I said, sir, and I was scared, if you really want to hurt me, why don't you hand me that thing and let me beat you? I was prepared now to be killed. And instead, he put it down and he laughed. That laid the blueprint for my whole adventurous life. My mouth got me out of trouble, and my mouth got me into trouble. My mouth made me a fortune, made me a millionaire. My mouth cost me a fortune and cost me a million. And that's how it's always gone. So I'm kind of looking forward to what it's going to say today. There is going to be a very slightly different mood in the country since the election of Donald Trump over Hillary Clinton. And of course, those two had a lot in common. They both love to grab pussy. But, you notice the mainstream media doesn't tell you about that anymore. You know why? Richard Nixon proved it decades ago when he was being interviewed by David Frost, and he said, when the president does it, it's not a crime. So they're not going to mention it because now he is president-elect. And right away, employment's gone up. 1 million jobs for protesters already. But he did not defeat Hillary Clinton. That's not the important thing. Most people I know they're not glad that Trump is in. They're glad that Hillary is not in. We came, we saw, she died. It's like when President Bill, the Ted Bundy of politicians, when we found out he was a serial rapist, the media treated it like it was a hobby, for Christ's sake. This documentary that we've just done did what reflects on what Donald Trump did. Donald Trump did not defeat Hillary. That's not the most important victory. He defeated what you all saw was an incredibly corrupt mainstream media. That was the victory. The documentary that we've just done, which was a year in the making, is very prophetic in that, because we didn't know that was the case when we started to do the documentary, and it airs at 1 o'clock. It will have its only pre-release screening at 1 o'clock at the Texas Theater. You're going to see a 99% film. How many of you saw the Garrison tapes? Applaud, please, because I can't see them. Well, for those of you didn't, shame on you if you're in the assassination community and have not seen the Garrison tapes and seen Jim Garrison's story. For those of you who have seen it, how many of you liked it? I am telling you right now, if you liked the Garrison tapes, you will absolutely love part two. It is 10 or 20 times more effective. When I first did the interview with Jim Garrison and he was talking about the media, this was September 5th, 1981, I didn't know what he was really talking about. I was making $30,000 an hour in the media. So, you know, I'm not going to talk about the media. I was interested in telling his story, that's all. I was a storyteller. I was not really that interested in the assassination. I was interested in telling what I thought was a great American story, and that was Jim Garrison's story. And it took me 40 years to be able to tell that story, and it cost me $300,000 of my own money to tell that story. The revelations in this documentary are absolutely staggering, and it is all an outgrowth of Jim Garrison's investigation into the murder of John F. Kennedy. Now, there are probably 1,000 people in the assassination community, and for over a year, when it was a year ago I started the film, we had a GoFundMe site for people to send in donations to help make the movie. Of those 100,000 people, how many do you think sent in a nickel or a dime or a quarter? Absolutely no one. We had 57 donations from around the world, and all their names are going to be on the end of that film to thank them when we finally get back to Los Angeles and redo the credits. Now, does this disinterest and this apathy in this community and in Americans in general shock or disappoint me? Absolutely no. Not at all. I am not judgmental. The smallest life form in the universe or on Earth is an amoeba. It's a single-celled creature that zoologists and biologists describe as pain-avoiding, pleasure-seeking. You and I are made up of billions and billions of those cells, which makes human beings more pleasure-seeking and pain-avoiding. So being apathetic is a natural condition for most people who are sheep. Now, when I say that we're sheep, I include myself in that. 98% of all Americans are sheep. 98% of all people around the world are sheep. A crowd has never made one single contribution to the betterment of mankind since the beginning of civilization. The only ones who make a difference in any society are the black sheep in that society. These are the solitary individuals who have this drive and this compulsion to contribute something to this society, contribute something to the improvement of life, and the black sheep are always denigrated in the beginning. Da Vinci, Galileo, Copernicus, Tesla, Einstein, Shakespeare, Mark Twain, John Lennon even, John Kennedy, and Jim Garrison. Jesus had only 12 disciples. Castro had 10 guys in a rowboat. I had 6 of the greatest black sheep in America dedicating their time and talents to helping make this movie. And I am telling you, as a former multiple award-winning critic, the first critic in America on the news to review movies or television, 10 years with Los Angeles Magazine, 5 years at KNBC, I am telling you, this is the godfather of documentaries. If you are not there Monday, somehow you're going to get to see it after January. I am telling you, as a film critic, I saw thousands of films. Any of you remember Philadelphia Story? The greatest opening of any movie I ever saw. Cary Grant's tossed up by Katharine Hepburn. She throws a golf bag after him, then grabs a 5-iron and breaks it and throws. He wants to come back and punch her in the face, just like Jimmy Cagney did, okay, with the grapefruit. Only he does, he takes his hand, he pushes her in the face. 3 minutes of pantomime and you know it's a great, great movie. The other was a movie that Clint Eastwood made 3 years ago. I don't know the name of the film. I don't go to movies anymore. But it was about an actor death experience, and it opened with a tsunami. The most wonderful, technically advanced opening of any movie I ever saw. It's a great film. If you, even if you're not interested in that subject, it is a great film. The first 10 or 11 minutes opening of the American media and the second assassination of President John F. Kennedy is the most thrilling opening 10 or 11 minutes of any movie that I have ever seen, because it is factual. And so I would urge any of you, and all of you who are coming, thank you so much in advance. But anyway, I told you I had six of these wonderful black sheep helping me. Now the white sheep, which is most of us, and I include me, we need shepherds. And the Central Intelligence Agency, which is the only branch of government that does their job properly, keeping us in the dark and misinformed, knows that. So they get rid of the shepherds, and Jim Garrison says in the movie, they do it every day and they're successful. Why should they stop? And it's always the peacemongers. It's John Kennedy, and it's Martin Luther King, and it's Robert Kennedy, and it's Malcolm X, and it's even John Lennon they probably murdered. There is no one left in America that can lead us to the Justice Department, where we should be, and not here, and not in New Orleans, and not in Pittsburgh. It is an open case, but we won't follow them because they're not rich and famous. They probably fear for their lives, but there are two people in this country that I would follow. And I'm not a follower, I don't join anything. I'm like Groucho Marx, who said I won't join a club that would have me as a member. Well, I am that way. I've been that way all my life. I've been on my own since I'm 5 years of age. But I would follow Oliver Stone, and I would follow Dr. Cyril Wack. They are the only two, and I hope one day they lead that parade there. Now, this is Judith Ferry Baker's conference. Lee Harvey Oswald's lover. I loved her book. And for the many people who tell me, and I'm telling you, there are a lot who tell me they don't trust Judith Ferry Baker, I inevitably say, I do not think anyone in middle age would risk the wrath of their government, the contempt of her countrymen, and the disenfranchisement from her family if there was not a lot of truth to her story. I hate bullies. America is a bully. I love underdogs. Truth is the underdog. Those people who malign Judith are bullies. And she is an underdog still fighting that fight. But that being said, Lee Harvey Oswald is to this case. Maybe not to Judith, and maybe not to a lot of others, but she is to the case. The murder of John F. Kennedy, what the CIA assigned him to be, and that is a discard, a patsy, a victim. But he is not the only victim. The 50,000 young men who died in Vietnam.
Yes.
Whose names are on that plaque in Washington, D.C. That plaque, that wall, is built mainly because of a story that we did on real people. They did not want to build a plaque to an unpopular war. The story I did on real people, unknown by nearly everyone in the world, is referenced and seen in the documentary. George Slaughter, who maligned more horribly than anyone I could imagine, since I was an eyewitness to it. When Jim Garrison said there were three teams of shooters in Dealey Plaza, George, and we were getting ready to do the story, and then at midnight he goes into the editing room and he changes it around, because at one point I asked Mr. Garrison, how many people do you think really knew he would die in Dealey Plaza? And he said, well, John, it started in 63 after the Bay of Pigs. And so he says, there are three teams of shooters. They're probably three men in a team because it's their most important kill, so they have a radio man. And he goes down the line, and all of a sudden he says, about 30. So anyway, when this airs in a show called Speak Up America, produced by George Slaughter, he has taken my field producer down into the editing room, and he re-edited my story so that when Marjo Gartner, the host of this particular show, Speak Up America, asked Mr. Garrison how many shooters there were in Dealey Plaza, Slaughter cuts to Jim Garrison, and he says, about 30. Then he calls me on the phone, says, what do you think? And I'm screaming at him, how could you malign Mr. Garrison? How could you malign him? So I slammed on the phone. I called Mr. Garrison in New Orleans, and tears are running down my face. And I said, I accidentally recorded him on a recorder. You can own NBC. You can own George Slaughter. Please file suit. I will be your main witness. I've got it all. And Mr. Garrison said, John, I would never see my family if I went to court every time the media maligned me. I'm used to this. I said, but you're not used to it like this. And I'm sobbing. And he said, John, we love your show. Please, just send us a few Real People t-shirts. And that's what I did. I sent a few Real People t-shirts, and the next day, I had lost that show, and America had lost that show. And it was the second time that that happened. Okay, so I'm telling you, I've never met a human being or an American as brave as Jim Garrison. Now, I'm going to tell you this quite honestly. If Lee had been a woman, and I loved that woman, I would certainly mourn the loss of her every year. But 364 days a year, I would be going after the killer. Now, we all know that Jack Ruby killed Lee Harvey Oswald. It was on television, so Dan Rather can't deny that. We all saw it. That's what I would do. But guess what happened? Somebody had to order Jack Ruby to shoot Lee Harvey Oswald. Nobody asked that question. Walter Cronkite, Huntley Brinkley, none of these people. The Warren Commission never even asked it. Guess who asked it? Jim Garrison asked it. And guess how easy it was to find out who ordered Jack Ruby to kill Lee Harvey Oswald. All he did was he got the phone records of David Ferry and Clay Shaw and all of these people. And guess what it led to? It led to a hotel room in Chicago. It was a room where a lady lived who was the mistress of a guy named Lawrence B. Myers. Now, Lawrence B. Myers' son is in military intelligence and in Dallas that day. It is one of the testimonies that you can see in the fictitious Warren report. Lawrence B. Myers, he admits he's at the Campania Hotel talking to Jack Ruby, but he says he didn't order him to shoot him when Jim Garrison knew very well. Now, how many times did you read about these things that Jim discovered? You never read about any of those things that Jim discovered. Jim Garrison, in 1967, solved this case. And as a result of Oliver Stone's wonderful movie, the Records Act was forced to be passed because hundreds of thousands of people demanded, after the success of Oliver's film, the justifiable success of that film, that these records be released. There is a 1967 memo, which is in the movie, that wasn't released until the Records Act was passed. And it says, we must help Clay Shaw, otherwise Jim Garrison is going to get a conviction for conspiracy. And I would urge you to stick around later and listen to Peter Janney, because his father signed that memo. Peter wrote a brilliant book called Mary's Mosaic, a terribly good book, and he's a wonderful speaker, and I would suggest you stick around and listen to Peter. But I'm going to tell you again how thorough Jim Garrison was. He did not just investigate Clay Shaw and David Ferry and all these CIA renegades. He went back to investigate the origins of the Central Intelligence Agency, founded in 1947 by Harry Truman, signed into law by Harry Truman. And the purpose of this, Jim says, is to control American foreign policy. Are you telling me I only have 10 minutes left? I am very sorry. Okay, I'm going to get to the end of this and say this very quickly. It was not drawn by an intelligence man or a military man. It was drawn up by a Wall Street lawyer named James Forrestal. James Forrestal began to complain about America's foreign policy because there was no reason for a fake Cold War against the Soviet Union, because American capitalism would have been crushed if there was no fake war, because American capitalism was in the military-industrial complex, about which they cowered. Eisenhower warned us about. He was a general. He could have done something as president. He left this carnage to a 43-year-old young man. Right. He had no chance against these people. Yeah. Capitalism would have collapsed. It was only saved by the Depression. Okay, now, James Forrestal is now saying, hey, we don't need this fake war. They lost 20 million people. And why is it that Israel is now having so much influence over our foreign policy? All of a sudden, they get together and they say, James Forrestal is nuts. And what do? They send him to the insane ward of Bethesda Naval Hospital, and on May 5th, he jumps out of the 16th floor window, supposedly committing suicide. Ironically, the hospital where they prevented an autopsy of President John Kennedy. And one of the doctors, Dr. Fink, who is called as a defense attorney in the trial, testifies why they were prevented from doing the autopsy by a bunch of generals led by Curtis LeMay. It is all in the documentary. So I'm going to say something. The CIA created Project Mockingbird to infiltrate every media in the country. The worst for CBS, NBC, The New York Times, The Washington Post. They still infest everything. CIA, cockroaches in action. Now I am telling you, if they can infect the big birds, they can infect the assassination sites. Because when the CIA plans a killing, they also plan containment. Why are there 12 assassination sites? They didn't kill a dozen presidents. They only killed one. Jim Garrison should have only one assassination site. There should only be one in this country. He solved the case. You follow him to the killers and those people in the media who protected them. You will clear Lee Harvey Oswald and everybody else they're blaming for this. It is that simple. Now what has happened since then, because of Jim Garrison's appearance on The Tonight Show and Late Night, he says very publicly, a branch of the Central Intelligence Agency killed our president. They heard that and they said, we don't want truth anymore. So along went the fairness doctrine, along went equal time. You won't hear those kind of truths anymore because you have no more voice in America. All you have left are your feet. And I hope you'll use them. Now, I'm going to have to skip to the end of my speech, unfortunately, because I had a lot of brilliant, informative things to tell you. So, what can I do as one individual? I can't do much. I don't have a hit show anymore. I'm not rich and famous anymore. But I can do what Jim Garrison, John Kennedy, and Thomas Jefferson urged us to do. The most intellectual president the United States ever had, followed by John Kennedy. John Kennedy was a peace president. They ordered us to speak up and seek redress of grievances. And this is how this documentary ends. One of the bravest people I ever met in my life, aside from Jim Garrison, is my co-producer in the film. Her name is Myra Bronstein. Myra is sitting right up over here. I would ask her to stand, but I don't want her to think she's a target. Anyway, what we did is we designed this 10 most wanted poster, because on September 5th, 1981, Jim Garrison said, John, there are a lot of people walking around who should be arrested right now for the murder John Kennedy. He gave me names, they're all dead. But today there are still people walking around who should be put under oath and questioned about the murder of John Kennedy. So what Myra and I did is we did what the Constitution and a few great men urged us to do, seek redress of grievances. This is a 10 most wanted poster. You can see around the edges there are dozens of people that you can recognize, but they're all dead. These other 10 are alive. It says, wanted for questioning and or waterboarding for the crime of obstruction of justice and the assassination of President John F. Kennedy. I will read you the four names. I delivered this at the end of the film to the Justice Department by myself. Dan Rather, who ordered him to lie to us about the direction that John Kennedy's head went when the bullet struck. The second one is Bill Moyers. Yes. After a rainy morning, this man who is Lyndon Johnson's closest aide orders the bubble top removed. I have offered him since 1992 when I made the garrison tapes. I offered Dan Rather since 1992 my last $25,000 for 5 minutes with them to ask them these questions that have been turned down. That's $5,000 a minute. And they all turned me down. Third is George Bush, who is fortunately for us still alive. He is the one man I know of who can't remember he was in Dallas on November 22nd, and even though there were photographs proving it. He sent a memo saying a guy named Murat was going to murder John Kennedy. And J. Edgar Hoover says, hey, we just got a memo from a CIA guy, George Bush. Okay? Zapata was the name of his oil company. It was the name of the code name for Operation Bay of Pigs. He was the head of the CIA and president of the United States. How despicable that the head of our secret police becomes our president and nobody utters a word about it. Had it been in Russia as it was with Putin, we hear about it day and night. And last, but not least, is Barack Obama. As the holder of the highest office in a democracy, he is the lead one to pursue the law, pursue the Constitution of the United States. The House Select Committee turned over to the Justice Department all of their files, urging them to continue, well, urging might be a strong word, suggesting. Anyway, put it in the cold case file, and if you get around to it, look into it. For Barack Obama not to pursue the law further and order that open is dereliction of duty. And he has a pen and a piece of paper like George Bush has, okay? He can sign executive orders like he does when he sends a drone overseas to kill a 16-year-old innocent boy. Why does he not sign an executive order demanding the release of all these files so we can see what this country has done to the president, has done to our democracy, and done to us? The last thing, we open the movie with a quote from John Kennedy, and I will close. This is at the bottom of this folder, which you will be, this is the first time anybody has seen it. That's one of the other reasons that I am here. At the bottom, John Kennedy said, those who make peaceful revolution impossible will make violent revolution inevitable. I want to thank you for letting me almost finish my speech. I am truly honored that you're here. I'm pleased there are so many people interested in this case, and especially in Jim Garrison. I wish you luck. I wish the country luck, because we need it.
Again, there will be a question and answer with John Barbour at the Texas Theater on Monday afternoon. I did put this in my opening remarks to John, but he probably figured it out. He started his career off as a comedy writer. And the other thing that I will say is, last year I spoke at another conference, and I had the misfortune of following up some guy you might know by the name of Jim Mars. So here's one of the top five guys in the assassination community, and my sorry ass has to follow him up. So now I just walked over to Jim a little bit ago and I said, now you're going to see what it feels like to follow up somebody else. Guys, his book, Crossfire, was, along with Jim Garrison's book On the Trail of the Assassins, the two books that Oliver Stone used for the movie JFK. The man is absolutely incredible. If you haven't seen the first Jim Garrison tapes that John Barbour has,